Okay, good afternoon. So last few classes we have been looking at different microbes being used in different industries or for especially for the human welfare. The first one we had looked at was the fermentation process, that is the alcohol production, and there were two types of alcohol that we had seen. The one which is like distillation product, and the other one is made up of without distillation. So these were the two like types of beverages in general. This was the overall structure of fermenter, and the main thing in this case that you had to remember was like, of course you can draw these diagrams in any different manner. You just have to remember to draw all these structures. If at all the question comes on where is the propeller or impeller and so on, like MCQ type from this. So that is the fermentation, and like I had mentioned, there will be like kind of match the pair type of questions based on the antibiotic sensors. So you will have to remember at least these two columns, antibiotic and what is the source of the organism. We had also looked few microbes which are specifically used in the organic acid production. So for example, Acetobacter acidi for acetic acid production, and Lactobacillus species, or the Streptococcus lactis. These were used for the lactic acid production. And like I said, the name of the organism is quite similar to the organic acid or the byproduct that they give rise to. So that way it's also easier to remember. And then there were few more in terms of organic acid production. Enzymes, there were various enzymes and their species of the microorganism that they are obtained from. So again, I'm not going to go into that detail. You can just make a kind of a table or so and just write down all these products with their organism. So that is the summary so far. And these were specifically used, three of these. Two of these specifically used for certain diseases or disorder. For example, insulin, you know, it is being used for the diabetic patient, and streptokinase is used in the patients with heart attack and so on. So these were different microbes. So now we are going to look at the use of these microbes in bioactive molecules. Now, what does bioactive molecule means? It has certain activity within the body cells. In terms of, these are not used for kind of infection by the bacteria. Rather, they are used to treat certain physiological situation. For example, cyclosporine A. This is produced by these fungus called as Trichoderma polysporum. And it is antifungal. So even though it is produced from the fungus itself, it can act as antifungal for certain pathogenic fungal species. And that's why it is antifungal. Anti-inflammatory, it reduces the inflammation, and also used as immunosuppressant or immunosuppressive agent in the organ transplantation. Cyclosporine A is actually very, very commonly used for most of the what we call as immune suppressed stages. Like let's say if you, especially in terms of organ transplant, skin transplant and so on, these cyclosporine A kind of like molecules, they are being used. So this is like a very specific action of cyclosporine A obtained from Trichoderma polysporum. Similarly, there are these molecules called as statins. This is like one of the most sold like drug molecule in the market, pharmaceutical market. That is the atorvastatin. This is the most commonly used. Of course, all the derivatives are also upcoming now. But this specific drugs, they are produced from the yeast, Monascus purpureus, right? So that is the name of the yeast. And these drugs, they inhibit the enzyme which is responsible for synthesis of cholesterol. So cholesterol is one of the high potential fat molecule which causes the deposition of these cholesterol or fatty acids on the walls of the blood vessels, and then it leads to the increase in blood pressure and ultimately cardiac arrest. So that is when in most of these patients where there is excess of cholesterol, what we call as HDL, LDL, high density lipids, low density lipids, and so on. So depending on what type of fat molecule is more within the blood or whole of the body, so that will need inhibition of the cholesterol synthesis. So the once the cholesterol synthesis is kept in control, all such disorders related to the hypertension or cardiac arrest, they are also reduced. So that is the use of the statin in the inhibition of synthesis of cholesterol. And the commonly used statins are atorvastatin, simvastatin, pravastatin, and lovastatin. There are various other derivatives as well, but these are the commonly used ones. So that is the use of this microbin bioactive molecule. So these are the two microbes and these are the two compounds that we know. Any question here? Any quick questions? Okay. So then the next use of this microbe is in the sewage treatment plant. I don't know if you have studied this before or not, but I just thought that I will take you over whole of this process and it will be in short. So you know what sewage is already. It contains a lot of wastewater and also contains these pathogenic microorganisms. And if usually that is the fact that it should not be discharged into the river or water bodies around. But that has been the case, I guess, at least throughout the India. Most of the rivers, they are polluted with the sewage water. So, but yeah, and that is when the sewage treatment plant, they are required. So, and because of this excess of sewage content, it may cause depletion of the dissolved oxygen in water. It's like the number of microorganisms increases because of the sewage water in the rivers or so, and that will increase the oxygen demand. So ultimately, the dissolved oxygen from water will be utilized by this bacteria, that water is rendered useless. And then this may affect ultimately all the other aquatic organisms because they are dependent on that dissolved oxygen. So that is the whole scenario and why it should not be dumped into the river bodies. So to make the sewage less polluting, it has to be treated with in the sewage treatment plant, which we short form as STP. And this STP usually has two processes, primary and secondary treatment. This is the usual schematic representation of the STP. We will see that and come back to this diagram. And this is like a diagrammatic representation in terms of steps what are being done. So again, we'll come back there. So in primary treatment, it's merely a physical process of removal of large and small particles. It's like when you sieve something or you strain something and you let go of one particular portion, right? Either the one which is large and small particles. So in this case, it's mostly kind of liquid and solid separation. So whatever is the large and small particles from the sewage, they are removed by the sequential filtration and sedimentation method. So the first step is the sewage is first diluted with water, shredded and churned. It is like kind of put through a lot of rigorous process. So that is what is shredding and churning. And it is then passed through the screens or skimmers to remove the large floating object. So whatever is large floating objects, they are removed. Whatever is maximum possible solid particles, they are also removed. So the filtered sewage is then passed through the grit chamber. Grit usually refers to that solid mass which is left behind, which is kind of like not gone out from the first filtration unit. So that is the grit, and that chamber is called as grit chamber, where this filtered sewage is passed, where the coarse solid matters settles down by gravity, and then the sewage is passed into the large primary settling tank. So if you look at this particular diagram, this first part, influent is the incoming water. It is like brought, it will be pumped, and that pumping is kind of making it a churn and shredding type, and then it is passed through the filter, what is written here as screening, and that is the sieving or straining activity, and then it is put into the grit chamber, that is grit removal. And if you see the depth of these chambers, they are also different, the shapes are also different, and so on. That is for a specific purpose, because here all of this content from the first screened sewage has to come into grit, where the sedimentation will happen. And once that sedimentation has happened, the rest of the next lot of the upper supernatant, you can say, is being put into the next tank, what we call as primary settling tank. So that is the primary settling tank with a gentle slope. So if you look at this primary sedimentation, you can see there is a little slope, and then there is all the sediment which is being collected here, and of course that is being, that will be removed from time to time. So that is the primary settling tank with a slope. The grit, the sand, and the other heavy particles will settle down, and the solid material and the screen organic matter constitutes of the primary sludge. So whatever is accumulated down as the sediment, that is called as primary sludge, because it's kind of thick material. So that is primary sludge, which can be used for preparing compost and manure and so on, and also used in the generation of biogas, which is quite obvious because it's a lot of organic material. It can be utilized for biogas or in the farming activities. And the remaining effluent, that is the top portion of the water or sewage, is then passed for the secondary treatment. So in the first, straining or screening is the first activity. Grit chamber, where it allows sedimentation, that sediment will be removed. This filtered sewage is then passed into the primary settling tank, which will generate the primary sludge again by the process of sedimentation or gravity, and of course the filtration, that is the screening, and then the whole lot of the sewage effluent is passed for the secondary treatment. Now in secondary treatment, this is a biological process. First, primary treatment, it was a physical process because it just involves the physical separation of the solid, liquid, and so on, or large particle and small particles. In the second treatment or secondary treatment, there is involvement of microbes. So involves biological process of the microbial degradation of the organic matter. And there are several methods of this secondary treatment. It can be oxidation tank or trickling filter. Trickling filter, they use certain bacteria along with the filter. Oxidation tank involves oxidation reactions. And then there is something called an activated sludge method. So in this method, the primary effluent, whatever the secondary tank that receives the primary effluent, is passed on to the large aeration tanks, where it is constantly agitated, that means kind of moved mechanically, and the air is pumped into it. So again, if I go back to the diagram, this is the secondary sedimentation tank, and it is huge. Usually it is kind of pumped with lot of pressure, so that the agitation is kind of movement, will keep on happening within the secondary tank, and then that will be allowed to settle later. So air is pumped into it so that it can remain moving. Some activated sludge is a kind of bacterial inoculum in terms of those microorganisms which will degrade the organic content of this primary sludge, that is what is called as activated sludge, is inoculated to allow the quick growth of the aerobic microbes, which form the flocks. Flocks are nothing but a complete mass of bacteria. That's what we, bacteria or algae or fungi, that is what is called as flocks. So this primary effluent will come into secondary tank. That tank will have air pumped into it, in which there will be bacteria or what we call as inoculum will be added, which is activated sludge. That means these are highly active dividing microbes, and this will form the flocks, which is the group of or mass of bacteria, algae and fungi. Now, because of these flocks present, it will consume most of the organic matter. That means they will break down that organic matter which is present in the sewage water. And this is how they will remove. So because the organic content is reduced now, and that is why the ability of other microorganisms to grow within that organic or less organic matter of the sewage will also be reduced. And that's what the biochemical oxygen demand of the effluent will be reduced as well. So this BOD is one of the parameter of sewage treatment. Higher the BOD, the water is very bad. Lower the BOD, the water is good. Obviously, if the oxygen demand of a particular water sample is too high, or biochemical oxygen demand is too high, that means there are a lot of other microorganisms growing, and that water is not good for drinking or even for daily usage. So that is the whole purpose of this sewage treatment, so that it will, the inoculum or the bacteria or microbe or flocks, whatever is added, they will use up all the organic matter, and whatever remaining water will be there, that will have less BOD. And so this water from the secondary tank is passed through the sedimentation tank. Sedimentation tank, these are just simpler tanks without any movement, where the microbial flocks are allowed to settle down. And that is what this settle down is used as the next inoculum, that is activated sludge, which we just spoke of. So this same inoculum will be used for the next lot of treatment. The major part of this activated sludge, whatever is sedimented at the bottom, is again pumped into a large tank called as anaerobic sludge digester. And this tank has oxygen-free atmosphere, where the anaerobic bacteria, they start digesting the microbes in the sludge. So because this situation is anaerobic, all the anaerobic bacteria, they will go and eat up or digest the aerobic ones. And that way, all the sludge will be completely neutralized. This is biological neutralization. Like anaerobic bacteria, they are not growing in the oxygen situation or wherever there is oxygen available. So it would be best that if we kill all the aerobic bacteria present within the sludge and allow the anaerobic bacteria to grow onto these aerobic ones. So that way the neutralization or biological neutralization will happen. And during this anaerobic digestion, the bacteria will produce mixture of gases, including methane, carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide. And these gases, they are flammable, and that's why they can be used as biogas. That is a, and the remaining sludge can also be used as a manure or part of compost. And the effluent, that is the water, which is treated after the bacteria, that can be released into the natural water bodies. So that is like whole of the sequence. So just as a quick revision, you have a sewage that you comminute, that means you screen through it or allow the filtration to happen, allow that to sediment, that is the grit formation, and then the primary sedimentation tank. This effluent will be taken into the aeration tank or trickling filter, and then secondary settling will happen, which will allow both of these will allow the sludge sedimentation or inoculation with the activated sludge, which happens in the sludge digester. And then the anaerobic bacteria will be added, which produce biogas, and the solid matter goes for manure burning or landfill, and the liquid is thrown into the river. So that is like kind of whole process. And again, just to show you here, after the sedimentation tank, there is this biological filter which has this activated sludge, and then after that the effluent is taken out, sediment is taken out separately. So this is like whole sewage treatment plant in a quick summary. Do you people have any question on this sewage treatment? So there are these microbes which are used in the sewage treatment as well. Okay, so I think there are no questions. So then the next usage of this microbe is in the production of biogas. Now, I assume you would know what biogas is, which is methane-rich combustible gas. Combustible gas means it can be burned. So that is the combustible gas, and it is produced by the anaerobic breakdown or the digestion of the biomass, which is the organic matter, with the specific help of methanogenic bacteria, or also called as methane producing bacteria. That's what happens in the biogas production. Composition of biogas is very, very important. Usually 50 to 70% of methane, 25 to 35% of carbon dioxide, very less concentration of nitrogen, and traces of hydrogen and hydrogen sulfide. But majority is methane, and that is what is used for the combustion. Carbon dioxide cannot be used for combustion. Also, there is, if the aerobic breakdown happens, then the carbon dioxide percentage increases. If anaerobic breakdown happens, then methane percentage increases. So that's also the difference when we produce the biogas. And the residue, that is the solid waste which is left after the biomass, can also be used as a manure in the farming activities. So there is this specific methanogenic archaea bacteria called Methanobacterium, and this is commonly found in the sludge, that is the activated sludge from the sewage treatment plants or STPs, and also found in the rumen of the cattle. And that is one of the major example why the cow dung is one of the very good fertilizer in terms of composting or manure formation, because these cattle, they are ruminants. That means they have this methanobacterium within their rumen, and that will ultimately come out in their in the cow dung. And that is what is, if it is utilized, that bacteria, methanobacterium present from the cow dung, that will cause the fertilization faster, not fertilization, the breakdown, aerobic, anaerobic breakdown of this organic matter. And that will produce lot of nitrogen containing compounds, which can act as a fertilizer for the farming, as well as producing the methane when the anaerobic situation occurs. So again, this is, I guess the diagram went too small. Let me just show you. So this is the general outline of the what we call as biogas plant. So there is a mixing tank, that is the influent, that means incoming material. There is a digester tank. Above the digester tank, which will hold, it's a kind of metal or rubber tube-like structure, which is huge actually, which is called as gas holder tank, because the gas is lighter than air, it will try to flow up, and then that is connected to the biogas outlet, that is especially in the kitchen or so, wherever it is connected for the usage of that methane. And the rest of this material, digester tank, it will be taken out later as an effluent in the outlet tank. and that is what is the general structure of this biogas plant. So it is 10 to 15 feet deep digester tank. Digester tank it is called so because that is where the digestion of this organic matter will be allowed in the presence of methane producing bacteria. And with a change pit for a passage of slurry into the digester, that is the incoming outlet or sorry inlet, and a floating gas holder, so that is the for holding the gas which is connected to the stove, and a pit for removal of the sludge that can be used as a manure or fertilizer. Usually the degradation of organic matter happens in three stages. In stage one, what we have in the organic matter that goes as a feeder in the digester tank or that goes in the biogas plant will contain proteins, fat, cellulose like material or hemicellulose like material. Like if we put let's say plant waste product from the farm, that will have a lot of cellulose. Proteins and fats can be obtained from again from the plants or any other human waste as well. That will be broken down into the soluble compounds or what we call as monomers. And this action happens with the help of enzymes like protease or lipase or cellulase. They will break down these compounds into monomers that will be converting them into organic acid again with the help of enzyme. And that will ultimately produce your biogas, that is with methane, carbon dioxide and so on. So these are the three different stages. First stage is the monomer conversion from the polymer conversion, from polymer to monomer conversion, then from monomer to organic acid and organic acid to biogas. So these are the general stages of this biogas production. Again, any question here? Anyone? Okay, so now a little different topic, miss. Maybe this you would not have heard before. That's why I'm saying different. So these are the microbes which are used as a biocontrol agent. Now, what is this biocontrol? It's ability to create an ecosystem which is favorable for growth of the plant or crops. So that is what is biocontrol. So in this, biopesticides are used, and these are the pesticides of biological origin. Like normally when we call pesticides or insecticides, these are chemicals we talk of. So these biopesticides, these are nothing but the biological molecules or biological organisms which are used to control the weeds and the pest. And that is why called as biopesticides. So the natural method of pest and pathogen control involves the use of microbes and other insects. And that is what is called as biocontrol or biological control. And these microorganisms, they are very, very helpful in maintaining that pesticide or insecticide action of the that particular microorganism. So it involves natural predation rather than use of chemical. So one organism survives on the other, and then whichever is on the top of the hierarchy in terms of predation, that will be used to kill the insect or pest that is harmful to the crops. So that way this natural predation is used, and the chemicals, they are obviously having a lot of harmful effects when they are used. So that way the biopesticides, they are much more better. So the organic farmers, they maintain a system wherein the insect pests, they are not eradicated. Usual purpose of like regular farmers, or what I can call conventional farmer, is just to kill all those species of insect or pest which are incoming or which are growing in their crop field. Right? But then in case of biocontrol agent, you maintain the system where the insects and pests, they are not completely eradicated, but rather they are kept in control using this ecosystem, like using certain bacteria or using certain other insects, which will feed onto this harmful pests or harmful insects in the farm. So there is something called as bioherbicides, which are living organisms and that control the weeds or the herbs in short. So there is this cochineal insect and the scientific name is Cactoblastis cactorum, right? And it is used to reduce the overgrowth of the cactus, right? So whole of that cactus family, and if it is growing too much, and this is especially like a very specific case dependent, because like if you see around, you may not have cactus growing, so you may not need it. But wherever the cactus grows very fast, you can use this insect, which is Cactoblastis cactorum, which will eat up the cacti and it will reduce the overgrowth of it. Then there is fungus called as Phytophthora palmivora. Phytophthora palmivora, it is again used to control the growth of milkweed virus in the citrus plant. All type of citrus plant, they have this infection with milkweed virus because the coloration of the leaves or the plant changes after infection, and that is why it is called as milkweed. It looks like that milkweed. So that is the fungus that is used to control this infection is Phytophthora palmivora. Again, you will have to remember these names, or at least by looking at it. If you don't remember the complete name, having a look at it, you should be able to identify the right answers and so on. One of the very interesting thing that is, I don't know how famous it is it in the farming community, but there is these two commercial products, Divine and Polego. These are developed using the fungal spores for weed control. Now, like nowadays, that fungus ecosystem has been studied very well, and that has been used. Like people have started using it in the farming. Rather than using chemicals, this fungal spores, what they will do is they will not allow the other insects to grow on the crop field. And that is where these fungal spores, they help. And also they are like, they allow the nitrogen content to reach or increase the aeration and so on. So there are too many advantages of growing fungus. But again, this is not any random fungus. These are very specific categories of fungus which can be grown, and these commercial products are already available. And then transgenic crops with the herbicidal resistance. I'm sure you would have heard of BT cotton, which we'll talk about it later. So these transgenic type of crops, they can have the herbicidal resistance so that they don't allow or they don't get affected by the growth of the weeds around them. So that is the transgenic crop, and these are the different ways in which these biocontrol agents can be used, and that was under the heading of bioherbicides. So these were all bioherbicides. Now we will look at the bioinsecticides. So these are specifically used for the insects. So there is this soil bacterium called as Bacillus thuringiensis. Yeah. So this is again one of the very famous, that BT cotton. BT stands for this Bacillus thuringiensis. So this bacterium can be introduced in the crop fields to control the caterpillar of the butterfly. So this particular bacteria, it produces a kind of insecticidal cry protein, which is a toxic material for these caterpillars of the butterfly. So when they eat this particular leaf of the plant on which these bacteria are there, obviously they will also eat up the protein, this toxin, and then they will die. And that is that is the use of this BT bacteria. And usually the spores or even they're just these bacteria, they can be mixed with water and sprayed on the crop as a bioinsecticide. So the moment these bacteria, they start growing on the leaf and so on, that will not allow the caterpillars to grow on that particular plant. So that is one method. Also, Bt cotton introduction of the gene for the toxin. So there is a gene which is responsible for this production of this toxin within the Bacillus thuringiensis. And that gene, if we take it out and introduce in the plant species itself, plant will start expressing that toxin, and that will lead to what we call as natural, genetically modified, not natural, genetically modified plants. And those plants, they will not allow these caterpillars to grow on them. So that is one type of bioinsecticide. There is something called as free living fungus, and the name is Trichoderma, which is very common in the root ecosystem. And this is effective in control of several plant pathogens. So what this fungus does is it actually goes and forms a layer over the surface of the root so that no other species can penetrate it and enter into the plant roots and so on. So that way it protects. And also Trichoderma is relatively very good in terms of production of the fertilizers within the soil, and that way it is like kind of very helpful as a biocontrol agent. Then there are baculoviruses, and the example is nucleopolyhedron virus. This virus, it can infect and kill many insect pests. So let's say if you have a particular crop field and there are insects or pests which are kind of eating up the crop, then you can spray this nucleopolyhedron virus, and that will kill or that will infect all the insects, pests, or even the arthropods on that crop, and it will ultimately kill those organisms due to the infection. So that is the use of baculovirus, and the example of baculovirus is nucleopolyhedron virus. Similarly, there is this entomopox virus, EPV, entomopox virus, which adversely affects the rate of development of the grasshopper because it will infect the grasshopper. So ultimately, grasshopper cannot develop completely. And ultimately, if the grasshopper is not developing completely, the food that it eats, that especially the leaves and stuff, that will be protected by this grasshopper. So that is again another strategy which is used in the bioinsecticides. So first one is the in bioinsecticide as a revision, Bacillus thuringiensis, which is Bt, and the same this Bacillus will create toxin. It will kill these insects. Secondly, the introduction of that toxin gene into the plant. Third one was the fungus, Trichoderma, baculovirus, entomopox virus. The next one is the fungal based bioinsecticide. So that is this Bovaria bassiana. That is one type of fungi which is specially used in controlling the forestry pest. Within the forest area, there are quite a few pests. To protect these plants, this Bovaria bassiana is used. Then the insect resistant plant. So there are quite a few plants which have been developed so far, in which the toxin gene of this Bacillus thuringiensis is introduced at the earlier stages, and then the seeds or the plants are produced from that, and that will spread out that particular gene into different plants later on. So that way it will also make the whole of the plant as insect resistant. So these are the different mechanisms of the biocontrol agents, and that's where the microorganisms, they are being used. So biopesticide, bioherbicides, and bioinsecticide. These were the three subcategories of the biocontrol agents. Now, there is something called as integrated pest management. Like when someone does a farming activities, with those farming activity itself, the regular some of the regular activities that can control the pests or insects and so on. So that does not need a special efforts, like we need not add certain microorganism, need not add certain what we call as fertilizers and so on, or insecticide, pesticide. Nothing will be required if we follow this integrated pest management approach. So this is the practice of pest control through biological method and use of chemical pesticide to a bare minimum. Like I said, it does not really need any of these, but of course, to some extent, as and when it is essential, they can be used to a bare minimum level. And that is again a biological method. That is very useful method. So what does it involve? It is to keep the pest population under control by using their natural parasites or predators. That is the first method, like letting the frog come in the fields, especially let's say rice fields. They will eat up the insects. So ultimately that chain is broken and the insects will not be harmful to the crops. To use the non-pollutant pesticides like pyrethrin. Pyrethrin is one of the chemical which is again a natural compound and that is found in this chrysanthemum cinerary folium. Chrysanthemum, I would assume that flowering plant, chrysanthemum flower, that is what contains this pyrethrin compound within that particular plant, and that is a pesticide by its nature. So that will not allow certain insects or pests to grow on the crop. So that is pyrethrin. Similarly, there is this azadirachtin. Like everyone knows the neem plant. So the name of the neem plant is Azadirachta indica. And that's where the name of this compound is coming, Azadirachtin. That is the genus name made into a like kind of a pesticide name. So that is also a natural pesticide. Again, you might have heard some of the organic farming practices. What they do is they collect the neem leaves, they break it down, crush them, mix it with water and spray it over the plant. So that way it acts as a natural pesticide and also acts as a repellent to quite a few other insects. So that is azadirachtin. And then third one is the cinerin. It is again a compound which is obtained from the chrysanthemum cinerary folium. And that also acts as pesticide. So again, this chrysanthemum plant parts, especially the leaves and the flowers, if you dry them, crush them, put it in water and spray it over the crop, they will not be harmful to the crop, but rather they will be more useful because they will block or control the pest within that farm. And then third action in the integrated pest management is growing the pest resistant varieties of the plant. Some varieties of the plants or crops, they are naturally resistant to certain pests, and growing them will help. Rotation of crops and mixed cropping. Mixed cropping is something like you plant two or three plants together, like corn and then the groundnut and maybe the sunflower and so on. So it's like mixed cropping. And the rotation of crops is like you don't keep on taking the same crop again and again, rather you keep changing the type of crop that is being taken. So that is what is integrated pest management, and that approach involves quite a few things, and these are done very, very naturally. Again, any question here, anyone? I guess I'm kind of rushing through, but there is nothing much to discuss about this. And these are just very simpler things. Only thing you have to remember is the names. Again, there are these two specific examples being mentioned in your syllabus where the microbes as biocontrol agents. So there is this ladybird beetles. I assume everyone know what is this ladybird beetles, because it's a very tiny spotted insect that you would know. So of ladybird beetles of many species that acts as a biocontrol agent of many pests, like especially the aphids. Aphids, these are the sap-sucking insects. This is what aphid look like. The first picture, that is the aphids, which will be eaten up by these ladybird beetles. So whenever, if we have ladybird beetles in the farm, they will be helpful in stopping the infection from the aphids. And then there is something, another biocontrol agent, that is the dragonflies. These are also very good biocontrol agent, especially for mosquitoes, yacids, and the several other Lepidopterous pest. Yacids, the example is given here. This is a typical representation of this yacid or jacid type of organism, which is again fall into the insect category. Mosquitoes, of course, you know, and several of the Lepidopterous pest. Lepidoptera is the order of these insects, which include butterflies and moths. So all of these butterflies and moths, they are included into this category called Lepidoptera. And when they grow on the particular crop, they will eat up when they have to grow. And that is why the dragonflies, they are being used, because they will control the all of these mosquitoes, yacids, as well as Lepidopterous pest. So these are the two specific examples of these microbes, which are used as, again, these are not microbes as such, these are insects themselves, but they are used as a biocontrol agent.
So,
yes.
So why would mosquitoes pose a threat to plants? Like, don't they only suck blood?
Not always, Pratham. So whenever the plants are young, no, the sap content of this plant, because they have certain lot of nutrition, that is when these mosquitoes, they goes and eat as well. And also, wherever the mosquitoes are present, the other insects, which are more harmful, they are also invited. So that is when dragonflies, if they kill mosquitoes, it's better. It's like one organism being present in the farm field that will invite the other one, which is a predator for that. And that way the insects will keep coming and they will keep harming. But then dragonflies, they don't eat up any of the plants as such. So that's when they are better in terms of use as a biocontrol agent. Okay, I guess what we can do is, there is hardly a small topic left, which is of 3 slides. We can continue it in the next class. We will stop for today. And next class, we will start the new chapter as well, that is the evolution part. This chapter was this small, that's when I took it front, first. There are 3 slides that will continue in the next class, and then we'll also start the evolution part, that is tomorrow. Okay, does anyone have any question? Okay, so then let's stop here. Thank you very much. Bye bye, and have a nice day. And I'll see you tomorrow.
Bye, sir.
Bye bye.